see where everybody's from. Some of you are from countries that I've visited over the last few years: Mexico, Peru, Italy, Algeria, Lithuania, and one or two of you are from countries that I hope to visit soon: Azerbaijan, Argentina, Bulgaria. Somebody just mentioned Bulgaria. I haven't been to Bulgaria yet, but I hope to soon. As a course book writer, I get to travel a lot. I get to meet administrators, I get to meet teachers, I get to meet students in many, many different teaching situations. And in fact, I think for me, that's one of the most interesting aspects of the whole of my whole job, really, that I feel like in some ways I'm in a bit of a unique position, because I get to speak to many different angles of our profession. And in some ways, I hope I get to, I have a bit of a privileged big picture, and I can draw together some strands. And today I want to talk about something in particular that I hear a lot of, and that's this concept of digital. Now, in teaching, we're very quick to recognize that we need to do something about the latest shiny technology. So in the 70s, we knew that we had to do something about video. And then through the 80s, DVDs came in, and then the internet and computers, and then the internet. And so as teachers, we're very aware, I think, that we need to have our finger on the pulse of these developments in technology. But I'm not sure we're always very clear on exactly how we need to incorporate them, because there is a danger that we can see technology merely as something shiny. It's shiny, it's new, we've got to have iPads in our classroom. And do you know what? If you put iPads in your classroom, your students are motivated, your students learn better. Of course they do, because you've put some shiny toys in front of them, but that effect fades. What are the real challenges when it comes to this concept of digital, and how are we really going to incorporate it into our classrooms? In fact, I think there's a bigger question to start with, which is, what do we even mean by digital? I speak to people in lots of different schools, universities, institutions of various kinds, and people say to me things like, we need to go digital. We need more digital in the classroom. Well, what do you mean by digital? I think there are at least three main areas that people mean when they use the term digital. And most of today, I'm going to concentrate on the third. The first, I think, when people say digital, they mean that they want to use computers and databases as a digital course management tool, LMSs, learning management systems, online workbooks, all that kind of thing. And by the way, what I'm saying today is in the context of my course, Open Mind, or the Mind series, Open Mind and its sister series, Mastermind. We've got people here from Europe and people from America. We've got two slightly different versions of the course in Europe and America. In America, it's generally known as the Mind series, which consists of Open Mind and then a higher level sister series called Mastermind. And in Europe, practically the same material is all referred to as Open Mind. So over the course of today, I'm going to use the term Open Mind to refer to the whole thing. But don't get confused, because it's slightly different in the American situation and in the European situation. So Open Mind, of course, like many courses right now, presents you with options for digital course management. So you look at the website and you will see something like this. Okay, this is Open Mind Beginner. This is what the teacher sees. It's a teacher facing management tool, and there are various, the units of the course book are reflected there on the screen. And then when you go into each unit, under each heading, there are various exercises that the students can do to support what they've been doing in the classroom. Okay, you're familiar with that kind of thing already, I'm sure. And then one of the interesting things you can do here is create what's called a grade book. You create a class, and then each student has a grade book. I've created a student here called Alec Smart. He's a smart Alec. You can see what I've done there. Alec Smart, and he actually hasn't attempted anything yet, because you can see to the right, he's done zero exercises. He's still got 32 exercises on unit one to do, so I haven't got a score for him. But as he does these exercises, I can build up various kinds of data telling me what he's getting right, what he's getting wrong, how many attempts it's taking him to get it right. One of the key concepts that you will hear more and more over the coming years is this idea of big data. The idea that we need to be what is measurable about our students' progress, we need to be measuring it, and then that feeds back into our classroom practice. Very powerful tool, and that's one big angle of what people, I think, mean when they say we're going to go digital. And that's a very important angle, but it's not what I'm going to be primarily talking about today. The second angle, the second aspect of digital is this, the use of digital as course content delivery. In other words, did the course books come with online resource centers, whatever they're termed, that often contain resources that students can access and that teachers can access, things like tests, etc. And with Mind, with Open Mind, we have fantastic online resources. And it looks like this is the 9 Series Second Edition website. In the back of your teacher's book, you get a teacher's web code to go and activate your account there. And then, as you can see in this slide, there are a number of different resource center compressed files. So what you do is you download one of the compressed files. I'll show you what that looks like when you open it. This is the Open Mind 1 mid-course test compressed folder. And when you open it, you get all the resources that you need to conduct the mid-course test. There are similar folders for each unit, end of term, etc. So this, in a sense, is providing you with all the stuff that complements what is happening in the course book. And that in some ways is very similar to what is happening in the course book. But of course, as I often say, as a course book writer, one of the things that limits me, one of the things that limits what I can do, is the amount that an average teenager can carry on their back. Because I can only produce books that are so thick, because often students have to carry half a dozen books to school, and you, the students, the publishers, won't allow writers to write beyond 120, 150, 180 pages. So there's always a lot of stuff that I want to include in courses that can't be included in the print components. And these online resources are a fantastic opportunity to extend the course so that at the end of the day, the student's book that you're looking at really is just the tip of the iceberg of the whole course, which is located online. So that's the second big aspect of what people mean when they say we need more digital, we're going to go digital. But to be honest, it's this third aspect that I'm going to talk about that I think we often overlook. And it's the idea of our students' needs in terms of digital competence or digital literacy. I'm going to use the two terms interchangeably. There are some people prefer one term and some people prefer the other. I'm not entirely convinced that there is much of a meaningful difference between them. I'm going to use them interchangeably. And we're going to explore what we mean by this whole area of digital competence. And we're going to talk about what it's got to do with us as English teachers. And I want to look at how we implement that concept in material. I'm sure you recognize all or almost all of these logos, because you will probably use all or almost all of these services. Twitter, Wikipedia, Instagram, Skype, Facebook, Snapchat, YouTube, LinkedIn, and I've kind of created my own logo there, really, but the Common European Framework. If you're anything like me, you probably use almost all of these. Personally, I use all of them except for Snapchat. I've never used Snapchat. I think it's one of those things where I've looked at it and I couldn't quite figure out how it would fit into my life, and then I haven't bothered going back to it. But the others I use on a regular basis. And I'm sure the same is true for you. Now, we're going to try this in the chat box. That's a very good point. By the way, I will be trying to keep an eye on the chat box, but of course it can be a bit distracting when I'm trying to talk as well. But if I spot anything from the chat box, I will try and comment on them. And as Lorena Jimenez, I hope I've pronounced your name something like correctly, says that our students use all of them, whether teachers are familiar with them or not. That's absolutely true. And they use a lot of other things, of course, that aren't here. This is just a very small sample of things that have developed over the last, in the 21st century, let's say. Okay. Lorena says, I've got reasonably close to the pronunciation, so thank you very much for that. Now, which one of these do you think appeared most recently? Have a guess in the chat box. Okay, very good. Okay, I guess in real life, if we were together in person, which I hope we are before too long, I would probably do this by a show of hands. I think the majority of you have got it right. Snapchat was the most recent. Let's just have a look at Snapchat developed in 2011. As you can see, going back in time, Instagram was next most recent. Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, Skype and LinkedIn, both in 2003. And Wikipedia and the Common European Framework, 2001. Since the Common European Framework was published in 2001, the online landscape has changed beyond recognition. And the things that I've put here are just a small example of how that online landscape has changed. It has changed beyond all recognition. The Common European Framework is ill-equipped. It is a very poor tool to help us in thinking about these questions of digital competence. In fact, if you look in the Common European Framework, you won't find that, you know, you can get the Common European Framework as a book, but you can also get it as a PDF, which is quite handy because then it makes it searchable. So, the term digital competence doesn't appear anywhere in the Common European Framework. Neither does digital literacy. The word digital doesn't appear in the Common European Framework. The internet appears 3 times. And the word computer appears 12 times. And it's always in the same kind of circumstance. It's in this kind of context. In section 2.1.1, the general competences of an individual. an individual should, it's describing about the ability, it's talking about the ability to learn. The ability to learn may involve facility in using a dictionary or being able to find one's way easily around a documentation center, knowing how to manipulate audio, visual, or computer media, e.g. the internet, as learning resources. This is very much Web 1.0. Very much the Common European Framework is a product of the 1990s. It was published in 2001, but the development work of it took place throughout the 90s. Now, this next one is very interesting, I think. Section 4.4.3.4. With the increasing sophistication of computer software, interactive man-machine communication, that's a bit of a clumsy way of putting it, but we'll allow them that. Interactive man-machine communication is coming to play an ever more important part in the public, occupational, educational, and even personal domains. Imagine that. Now, this is fantastic. This looks like it's gesturing towards the kind of area that we want to explore. But that's it. If you go and look at that section of the Common European Framework, literally, that's the end of that section. And then it starts talking about something else. So in a way, they could glimpse that this was where things were going. Perhaps as any of us could glimpse where things were going in 2001. But in terms of dealing with that interactive man-machine communication, and in terms of understanding the important part that digital competence plays in the public, occupational, educational, and personal domains, those digital life skills, the Common European Framework isn't much help. And then the last one is very revealing. It's talking about the kind of media that students need to understand, and media include computer, email, CD-ROM, etc. Again, a bit of a throwaway inclusion of digital things, and very much Web 1.0. If you take nothing else away from spending half an hour with me today and exploring these ideas together, this is the thing that I want you to take away. In 2013, the European Commission Institute for Prospective Technological Studies published this report, DigComp, a framework for developing and understanding digital competence in Europe. Now, you can find it at that short URL that I've created, or you can search for DigComp Ferrari. Ferrari is one of the writer. I encourage you to you can get it for free online. I encourage you to get that report, read it, and reflect on it in the context of materials you're using in your classroom, in the context of your classroom practice, in the context of your own digital competence. And the rest of what I'm going to talk about now for the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to explore how this report is put together and how we can use it in, how I can use it in materials, how you can use it in your classrooms to systematically develop this concept of digital competence. Because unless we have some kind, one of the beauties of the Common European Framework, for all its occasional faults, one of the beauties of the Common European Framework, which of course was one of its aims, is that it has given me and you and teachers around the world, far beyond Europe, it's given us some kind of common language that we can base our levels on in particular, but much more than that. It has given us a whole way of talking about language use and language ability that has been revolutionary, really. When we consider digital competence, we need some kind of similar firm footing so that we're talking a similar kind of language. Essentially, we need a Common European Framework that includes the digital. This is a very long way towards it. If we use this report alongside the Common European Framework, I think that this is the way forward in considering this whole area. I've been using this term, digital competence, without explaining. I see one or two people are just arriving late. Thank you very much for joining us anyway. You haven't missed much. You only missed the bit where I promised everybody else £50 for arriving on time. But please just find a seat quickly and sit down and join us. What is digital competence? In DigComp, this is the definition that they use, that digital competence can be broadly defined as the confident, critical, and creative, three key notions, confident, critical, and creative use of ICT to achieve goals related to work, employability. Employability is the particular focus of what's happening the rest of today in these webinars. Learning, leisure, inclusion, and or participation in society. Now, this is interesting as well. Digital competence is a transversal key competence. What they mean is, not only is it a key competence, it's involved in developing other key competences. It underlies a huge amount. It's related to many of the 21st century skills which should be acquired by all citizens to ensure their active participation in society and the economy. Okay. Why does it matter? Well, on the one hand, of course, from our own personal experience, we understand that digital literacy for participation in the 21st century is fundamentally as important as literacy was for participation in the 20th century. We spent the 20th century, at least if I talk about the UK, the story of UK education ultimately boils down to making sure that as close as we can get to 100% of our population is literate. The challenge for the 21st century is making sure that as close as we can get to 100% of our population are digitally literate. It matters because it underpins so much of our economic life, our social life, our academic lives. Just in case you needed one other more official statement of how important digital competence is, in 2006, the EU produced the European Recommendation on Key Competences for Lifelong Learning. And you can see ones that particularly interest us are ones like number two, communication in foreign languages. And of course, we can't really claim to be interested in that without also being interested in one, developing communication in the mother tongue. And number four, digital competence. It's a key competence that underlies so much of other skills and abilities. As DigComp says, participation in society requires a set of competencies related to technologies, which have started over the last decade to be understood as life skills, comparable to literacy and numeracy. It is becoming to be digitally literate is as important as being able to read and being able to count. Partly because these are the conduits of power within our societies. The way in which we consume information, respond to information. Look at what happened in the referendum, the EU referendum recently in the UK, where information, control of information, checking information and claims played a central role to that whole debate. By the way, I'm very gratified to see terms like life skills being used. When we first worked on Open Mind and started to bring life skills into that course, it felt a little bit like we were feeling our way in the dark. And when I spoke about life skills at various conferences, I guess I started talking about life skills at conferences in 2009, 2010. And then it felt very much like I was having to do a job of convincing people. Today, when I talk about life skills, I feel like I'm pushing against an open door. It's very much a concept that is in the ether, that is in our professional atmosphere. And I'm proud of the contribution that myself and Open Mind have made to focusing our attention on that important area. Now, this, I think, is very interesting, isn't it? The competencies and competence areas that are here defined can be seen as components of e-citizenship. That's kind of what I was just talking about. The issue of digital divide. It is, in fact, recognized that participation in the digital domain is no longer a question of have and have not, but an issue of competence. We are all haves. We are all users of the internet, of smartphones, of Facebook, of email, of Instagram, of WhatsApp, of whatever it is. Yes, there is still a small segment of society who have never been on the internet, who don't know how to use these tools, but that has become a minor problem. I'm not saying it necessarily should be completely ignored, but certainly amongst your students, it's probably almost non-existent. There are very few students who are not at least as comfortable with going online and doing stuff as you are. In fact, I think there are a decreasing number of teachers who are not comfortable doing that. We are all haves. It's no longer about haves and have-nots. Now it's about what does it mean to be a have? What is your competence? Because we all do it. How well do we do it? And as DigComp says, it depends more on knowledge, skills, and attitudes. These are the things we should be focusing on, not so much access and use. There are one or two interesting access and use things connected to the idea of accessing different types of knowledge. And we're going to look at a little bit of that, but the focus is on knowledge, skills, and attitudes. The DigComp framework takes a hierarchical organization approach. And we hit a little bit of a problem with the English language. I've just been distracted by a comment in the chat from Alexandra Rakoniak. Again, I hope I've got somewhere near the pronunciation. She says, "You can't imagine how many students don't have the internet because for them it's a scarce commodity, it's expensive." Absolutely true in some parts of the world. Now, what I'm going to come on to discuss later, the examples I'm going to use to explore digital competence, I want to make the point that dealing with these high-tech concepts doesn't necessarily need to be a high-tech exercise in itself. I think that we can get a long way considering these things on paper. I don't believe that every classroom needs to have a whiteboard, an interactive whiteboard in the corner connected to the internet. Otherwise, there's no point thinking about these issues. I think that we can reflect on and get a long way considering them together, even without being connected to the internet. So I'm going to come to some low-tech responses to this high-tech issue. So the DigComp framework we run into a slight problem with the English language, which is that we're asking the word competence to do many things. Overall, we have this concept of digital competence. And we're going to divide that up into separate competence areas. And then within each of those competence areas, there are individual competencies. You see how it starts to get a little bit confusing in the English language. I ran into this, and then another confusion that we always have is the difference between competence and competency, and different people disagree about what the difference is, or even if there is a difference. So just try and keep in mind that we're talking about these different levels of analysis. Now, we're going to do a quick chat box vox pop. And this is the central concept of digital competence. What words do you think are going to appear as the key competence areas within this overarching concept of digital competence? Software is, okay. Good. I think I'm going to encourage you to think a little bit more abstractly, away from software and internet. Computer. Word processing. That's an interesting one. Yeah. Okay. Very good. Right. You've got one or two of them. Okay. Here's my first one. Information. And this is maybe where the Common European Framework can be somewhat relevant, because some of the information that we access online is stored in library-like contexts, in documentation centers. So information is about identifying, locating, retrieving, storing, organizing, and analyzing information, and then at a higher level, judging its relevance and purpose. Key skill, key literacy skill. I'm going to go through these a little quickly because I've got 10 minutes left. Communication. Somebody mentioned that. Somebody just mentioned that. This is about communicating through online tools, sharing resources, collaborating. Now, this is where something like the Common European Framework is useless, because this idea of getting involved, contributing to the online world, is something that post-dates the Common European Framework. An important, by the way, I'll just go back to that one, an important thing at the end there, important thing for our students, cross-cultural awareness. The third one is content creation. A few people in here mentioned creativity. Creating and editing content, somebody mentioned word processing. Integrating and re-elaborating previous knowledge and content. In other words, mashing up existing content. Producing creative expressions, media outputs and programming. And then the issue of copyright, plagiarism, etc. Safety. We're going to look at that in a bit more detail shortly. This is about protecting your own data, your own identity, the security of your devices, and this is where the environment comes in as well, safe and sustainable use. And the last one that they identify is this key critical thinking area of problem solving. So this is about identifying needs and resources, making informed decisions, solving problems through digital means, creative use, technical problems, updating your own and others' competence. Okay, so this, according to the way DigComp is structured, this central idea of digital competence has five main competence areas. Now we're going to look at two of those. We're going to look at information and we're going to look at safety. Now, the general description I've shown you already. Now, within information, the report highlights three main competencies: browsing, searching, and filtering information. Now, browsing and searching are obvious. Filtering is a more demanding skill. Evaluating information, storing and retrieving information. Now, if you look under each of those then, this is where it starts to look very like the Common European Framework. You look under each of those, here I'm looking at 1.2, evaluating information. And because it's not as developed as the Common European Framework, where the Common European Framework gives you six main levels. This report gives you three: foundation, intermediate, and advanced. So the first level of evaluating information is to know that not all online information is reliable. You do all know that not all online information is reliable, don't you? I'm not sure that's true of everybody, but if they get to a foundation level of digital competence, they realize that don't believe everything you read on the internet. And at an intermediate level, you can draw different sources together and compare them. And then in an advanced level, you can draw them together, you're critical about the information, you can cross-check and assess the validity and credibility. So this is the kind of journey that we want to take our students on in terms of evaluating information. Now, I mentioned knowledge, skills, and attitudes. I won't read these out, but you can see the kind of knowledge required, the kind of skills required. The first one is very interesting, is able to deal with information pushed at the user. You know, just a very quick example, my mum and dad, they both passed away in the last 18 months. But before that, I was very much their technology guy. And so I would help them to try and cope with certain things on the internet. And they liked Facebook, all right? They liked Facebook. And what I could see happening with them was exactly the lack of this skill of being able to deal with information pushed at the user. So they would look at Facebook, look at the screen, and then over here somewhere, an ad would appear. And they would constantly get distracted by the ads or by some other information. They didn't have that key skill of being able to filter out what is irrelevant and what's relevant. Very interesting to see that in action. And then the attitudes that are relevant are these. Okay. Now, and then the report goes on to show you how to apply it to different purposes. In this case, this is an educational context. So at a foundation level, you might find some information about society in the 1500s, but you're not sure how reliable it is. At an intermediate level, you found a range and you can cross-check them to begin to understand how reliable any one of them might be. And then at an advanced level, you've got a range of sources and you can reject some of them as not as clearly being unreliable. You can check the sources that these sources are based on. And this is a far more sophisticated way of interacting with the material. In the course of employment, we're talking about employability. At a foundation level, you've been asked to look at sales of certain products, but you're not sure how reliable the figures are. At an intermediate level, you've got different sources and you can check them against each other. And then at an advanced level, you've checked the sources, you've taken out the ones that are unreliable, and you can begin to put together a much more sophisticated understanding of the information that you're receiving. How can we use it? Well, I think there are three main things that I want to encourage you. I'm probably not going to have time to go through the whole of what I was going to talk about, but I might just very quickly shoot through it, and you can look at it more at your leisure later. First of all, develop our understanding of our students' needs. Where are they? Where do they need to get to? How can we systematize that? Where are we? Where do we need to get to? We are all digital lifelong learners. Even if you know everything there is to know about the digital world right now, your knowledge is obsolete tomorrow and something else has come along. Something else has disrupted the online world. And it's and it's your job to get up to speed with it. There are only two options in the digital world today: keeping up and falling behind. And our classroom tasks and materials need to incorporate this whole area and develop the relevant language skills. Let me show you very quickly. I mentioned access skills, and this is about a low level, a foundation level of information access. All your students will know how to use Google or some other kind of search engine. But that important skill is knowing how to use it efficiently and effectively, and then knowing what kind of results you're getting back from it. So in this double page spread, and this is a life skills lesson from Open Mind. Students are going to consider what search terms are going to be useful. They're going to consider how different search terms are used in different areas. If you look at task C, this is search terms work on Boolean logic. And so you can, for example, Indian culture minus celebrity will return results for Indian culture, but will remove results connected to Indian celebrity because you're in this context, you're not interested in them. So our students can use Google, but we can make them better users of Google. And then this shows typically what kind of results you get from Google by putting in certain, in this case, by putting in the term India globalization. And now they can start to use their literacy to filter the information even before clicking on them, something that we need to learn to do automatically, because we're all going to die one day and we do not have time to click and follow through every single link put in front of us. So the ability to filter links is a key thing to be able to do in a foreign language. At a more advanced level, this is now an intermediate level, a digital competence intermediate level, that here students are, they choose a topic to research in task A. And then in task B, they consider different sources of information and consider what kind of information they can get from those sources, the advantages and the disadvantages. And remember, some of it might be pre-digital. Some information still only exists in books. So students still need those traditional skills, or at least they need to understand what the advantages and disadvantages of those sources are. And that's the flow of the lesson here. And then at an advanced level, this is a life skills section on the life skill of evaluating internet source reliability. This is an advanced level of digital competence. This is about looking at a website, thinking about how convincing some of its claims are, considering the logic of it. So these three life skills lessons show you the kind of progression that I would like to see in my students in terms of their digital competence and their understanding of that in English. Okay, now I'm just literally going to click through this just so you can see it, because I'm running out of time really. But I want to consider the area of safety, and I want to look at this. That's a mistake. Sorry. Ignore where it says evaluating information. That should mention safety. But when you look at this presentation later at your leisure, you'll be able to see the knowledge, skills, and attitudes that are connected to safety. This again is a life skills lesson on safety. This is about, and I want to show you here how I'm linking it very strongly into my students' language needs. Because of course, you could be doing all this work in their first language. Why specifically in English? Because some of it demands an understanding in English and demands responses in English. So students here read about protecting themselves online. And then they are responding to a question on an online forum and they have to take the information that they've acquired, put it into a short message that they then post online in response to somebody's question. So I'm working with the competence area of safety, and then I'm leading into the competence area of communication. This is at a much more advanced level. This is about building an online community. Online communities are things like, as you can see in task A, hobby clubs, social, political, or religious groups, online social network sites, online forums, the kind of things that the vast majority of us take part in one way or another every day of our lives. So students choose something that they're going to set up, and then they work through tasks B, C, and D. They work through putting together their community that they're going to build online. Now, this is the kind of thing that is very much beyond the scope of the Common European Framework. It hadn't even been conceived of when the Common European Framework was published, but is very much a key element of an advanced level of digital competence. So we're going from the competence area of communication through to problem solving and content creation. All right, I'm going to leave you. Well, I'm not going to leave yet, because I'm going to try and deal with one or two of your questions if I can. Alvin Toffler, I don't know if you've heard of him. He was a futurologist. He died recently. He died about 2 or 3 weeks ago, something like that. He wrote a book called Future Shock, which was probably the most successful attempt to predict now from the 1970s. And I loved this quote of his: the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. Remember, we are beyond the age of access being the issue or being the main issue. We're in the age of competence being the main issue. Okay, thank you very much for listening to me so far. Have we got any questions? Henry, I don't know if you've picked any up from the box, or if anybody would like to type in any questions now. How can you get a certificate? I've got absolutely no idea. Henry will deal with that. Unlearning and relearning, that's the point. I completely agree. If you've written your question already, then maybe write it again, because it's probably scrolled up and I've missed it. All right, thank you very much for your thanks. Henry, did you pick up on any particular questions that I should deal with? I mean, really, For those of you who came late and maybe missed what I said, what I've been talking about today isn't really rocket science, but go along to find the report DigComp, and that will give you a framework. Now, somebody says here, how can we promote competence in classrooms where students don't have the internet? Do you mean they literally don't have the internet in their lives at all? Do you mean you don't have the classroom in your English language? You don't have the internet in your English language classroom? I mean, I think what I wanted to show you by showing you those pages from the books was that, of course, in action, students need to be able to access the internet. In fact, students need to be able to access the internet, but we can get a long way without even bringing the internet into our classroom, with nothing more complicated than pen and paper. You know, in 2009, I gave a talk at IATEFL. I gave a keynote address at IATEFL, where I said that there was one piece of technology that I was convinced was going to be in our classrooms for a long time to come, and probably to the end of my career, and probably to the end of your careers, and that is the book. because it has a number of advantages still over electronic forms. And I think that in circumstances where, if you've got the internet in your classroom, it's fantastic. You can do all kinds of things. Of course you can. If you don't have the internet, then I think you can get a long way by using paper, using materials like Open Mind that incorporate this into the onto the page, and by reflecting on and discussing these things. And then, if students do have internet access at home, they can go away and practice them. If they don't, perhaps there's some way you can provide internet access yourself. I noticed that Alexandra says that she uses her own internet provider to help students. So I think there are always options, and there are increasingly options, I think. Okay. All right, thank you very much, everybody. I guess I'm going to hand over to you now, Henry. Thank you for allowing me to overrun my time. It's been great to speak to you. Thank you so much to all of you for coming along. Those of you who I've seen before, thank you for coming back to listen to me again. If I've never seen you before in your country, and I've seen a few countries there I haven't been to, was somebody from Gabon? I hope to come out to Gabon before too long. I hope to meet you in person somewhere down the line. I'll leave you one more slide. I'm on all the usual, I'm available in all the usual outlets. Come and find me on Facebook. One of those is my professional page and the other is my personal page. I don't really draw much of a distinction, so come along and sign up to whichever one you feel comfortable with. Come and be my friend. I'm on Twitter and I'm on Instagram. I'll see you online. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. Great job. Okay, so for those of you looking in the chat box now, my colleague Forzia has put some very helpful links about the courses that Steve has written for us there. And just take a second to check those out. And also take a note, please, of Steve's channels too, so that you can follow him on Facebook and ask any further questions you may have. Okay, I'm now going to move us on to the next presentation, which will be delivered by Mickey. So there's going to be a short break while we get things ready here. Just a couple of minutes we'll need. And you should eventually hear Mickey over your speakers. So she'll just need to test things to make sure that it's all working fine. So Mickey, if you can hear me now, I've made you a presenter, which means you should be able to start setting up the camera and the microphone. Okay, so hopefully we'll start to see in a second, but just bear with us. So we can all see you, but now you just need to turn your microphone on at the top of the screen. That's it. So if you try saying something.
Okay, can you hear me? I have set up my microphone.
Yep, I can hear you.
Okay. And actually, Henry, I just emailed you a question. Yeah. How do I get that notes format on there?
So where you see the two arrows in the bottom left-hand corner of the slides, there's a white rectangle.
All right.
And then you just need to press that. And then you press the notes tab on that pop-up that appears.
Great.
Hopefully they're there.
They're not there. It's okay. I've got them printed out. So,
well, they may appear as you move slides.
Oh, yes. Oh,
They're
right.
associated with a different
Oh, yes.
name.
Okay. All right.
Perfect.
So, let me know when we're ready, when we should start.
We're good to go now if that's okay with you.
I believe we're starting about 10 minutes late. Is that correct?
Sorry, but that's fine. Don't worry. You can have the same amount of time for Zia. We'll just begin a bit later.
Right. Okay. Hello, everyone out there. Can you hear me? Can someone let me know if you can hear? Great. Great. Well, thank you for staying on. I was listening to some of Steve's talk. That was very interesting. As you may know, I am one of Steve's co-authors on the Mind series. And Steve was speaking specifically about a digital competence. We probably should have had the talks reversed because I'm actually going to talk about a little bit about employability skills in general today. What students need to know. So as you know, education has changed a lot in the last 10 years or so. If any of you have been teaching more than 10 years, have you? I hope. So increasingly, we are asking students to take responsibility for their own learning, to take initiative, to think critically, things like that. But in order for them to do that, they need to understand what we're asking them to learn and why. And in some cases, obviously, this is obvious. I mean, clearly, you need to know about verb tenses in order to use the correct tense when you speak or write. So those things are very clear. But we no longer teach just grammar and vocabulary and things related to those. We now want our students to develop skills like the ability to work effectively in teams or to think critically. And these things, along with things like speaking English well or knowing engineering or whatever, are what we call employability skills. And for these for the types of skills we're going to be discussing today, it may be a bit harder for students to understand what the skills are, why they are useful, and how to develop them. And that's a question that teachers often have as well. I was noticing a few of the questions or comments when Steve was talking, and some of the comments were, how can we teach this? How can we develop these skills? How can we evaluate these skills? So we're going to talk a little bit about that today. The ideas that I'm going to present are actually not original to me, but they are things that we have worked with in our in the Mind series and in other courses for Macmillan. But this particular sort of concept or procedure, I guess I should say, that we're going to talk about today was developed by the Australian Education Department. And you can find it online, but there's going to be a handout posted after this talk so that the handout will have the website, so you don't need to copy any of this down or take notes because you will have access to a handout that gives the procedure I'm going to talk about as well as the websites. So let's take a look at how this can work. So the idea is that we want our students, I mean, teachers nowadays are pretty familiar with this concept of soft skills, transferable skills, life skills. But students are not necessarily. And, you know, we can't just assume that this is automatically going to be clear to them. So, what can we do to help students understand all of this stuff before we, you know, work on ways to develop it? First, we need to obviously introduce the terms, employability, hard skills, soft skills, also known as transferable skills, also known as life skills. Now, if you have beginning or lower intermediate students, you may need to do this in the native language. It's very important for students to understand the information, understand the concepts. So We are going to first introduce the terms. So what is employability? What do we mean by that? Well, as defined by the University of Edinburgh, it is a set of achievements, which are skills, understandings, and personal attributes that make graduates more likely to gain employment and to be successful in their chosen occupations. And this benefits them, the workforce, the community in general, and the whole economy. Hard skills are the specific skills and knowledge that you need in your professional field. So if you're a doctor, you need to know what medicines do. If you're a teacher, you need to know teaching techniques. You might want to ask students, you know, professional areas or jobs that they're looking at. What kinds of hard skills do they need to know? You know, if they're going into engineering, what do you need to know? Well, you need to know about, you know, types of metals and construction materials, that kind of thing. Soft skills or transferable skills are the ones that are a little harder to define. These are generic skills that are developed in one situation, which can be transferred to another situation. This definition comes from Trinity University. So, for example, these are things like working well in a team, thinking critically and asking good questions, or managing your time effectively. And those things are obviously useful in all types of jobs, and not only in jobs, but in your personal life and in your academic life. Okay, so we want students to understand what we're talking about before we can possibly ask them to start developing these things. So that would be the first step. Again, all of this is on a handout. You don't need to take notes or write anything down. Second step, we now want to work with students to help them identify the environments, or we call these things domains. You can use that word or not, it doesn't matter. But this is where transferable skills are useful. Now, you may want to actually elicit this information from the students, you know, help them, get them to figure this out. So you might want to give them one domain or one environment, say school, and ask the students to say what other areas there are in life. Well, there's work, there's home life, there is social life outside the home and family. What we mean when we talk about transferable skills is that these are skills that the same skill, you know, time management, for example, is useful in all of these different areas. Then the next thing we're going to do is hand out a table to the students so that, again, they can see a list of these skills. Just as with the four skills of listening, speaking, reading, writing, these skills also have sub-skills. In other words, there are specific sort of mini skills within the larger skill areas. So this is a table, again, to help students understand what we're talking about when we talk about these things. So again, this table is in the handout, so don't panic if you can't see it that well. Can you see it? Can you see this? All right. Good. Okay. People are saying yes. Great. So, you know, the skill area of communication and interpersonal skills. So it defines what we mean by the skills. So in this case, it's the ability to explain what you mean in a clear and concise way, both in written and spoken forms. And it's also to listen and relate to other people and to act on key information or instructions. So communication isn't just about, you know, knowing English or speaking well and clearly in your own language. It also has to do with how you relate to other people and what you do with information. So what does that mean? So examples, if you look at the sub-skills column. Oh, someone is saying, Henry, someone is saying, Samara is saying that they can't hear me. Can people hear me? Yes. Okay. Good. Samara, I hope that sorts out for you. Okay, good. All right. Okay, fine. Thank you. All right. So sub-skills of that, for example, and these are some examples. There are more sub-skills than this, but these are examples, again, to help the students and maybe sometimes to help us as teachers understand what we mean by these. So for example, in communication and interpersonal skills, we have things like listening actively, speaking clearly and directly, empathizing, being able to put yourself in someone else's place and imagine how that person feels, establishing and using networks. And this gets into some of the things that Steve was talking about. Being assertive, and that doesn't mean being bossy and, dominant, but being assertive and, making yourself understood, sharing information. If we look at problem solving skills, these are things like thinking logically, developing solutions, etc. So, the idea of this is just to define what we're talking about here to the students and give them some examples so that they can, understand what we're talking about here. So this is just the second page of that. So all of these skills areas on the left are the, the broad skill, and then you have the definition, and then you have some examples. Excuse me. The sources are listed here. These sources, these websites are listed in the handout that you will get. So you can go over this table with your students. Again, you can see that if you have lower level students, English level students, you may need to do this or a lot of it in the native language. But, that's okay. Sometimes we need to do that to get students to understand concepts, rather than trying to force them to understand a lot of big words in English that they don't know yet. Then the fourth step here, the students now have their table of skills. Again, that skills table is in the handout that you're getting, so you can make copies of that for your students. So have students refer back to the table, and we're going to ask them to make a list of, we want them to list skills that they have learned outside the classroom that they think can be used at school or at work, again, in those domains. So some examples of this might be things like negotiation skills, empathizing, being assertive, working in a team, using math for budgeting, especially if students are, married or living on their own, not with their families, they may have to make budgets, for their everyday lives. Negotiation skills. We think of negotiation skills as a business skill, don't we? But how often do you have to negotiate something in your family? Some people want to go to the beach for the vacation, and other people want to go to the mountains. And you have to negotiate that and figure out what to do. And sometimes we have to compromise and we say, well, this time we'll go somewhere different, or this time we'll go to the mountains, but next time we'll go to the beach. So these kinds of skills are used in everyday life, not just in business. And then the other list that they're going to make is of some skills that they have developed at school or in extracurricular activities, related to school, like sports or music or arts, that can be useful at work or at home or in their social lives. Some examples of this might be speaking clearly. They might have learned that in their, in their language classes. Thinking logically, taking responsibility, managing time, working with different types of people. Maybe some of them are in schools where they have international, people from different countries, or at least different kinds of people, people with very different sort of attitudes and beliefs. So two things are going to do here: list some skills that they've learned outside the classroom and list some skills that they have learned in school or in activities related to school. What's the reason for this? Well, very often, this stuff all sounds a little bit overwhelming. You say, oh my gosh, I don't know what these skills are. I don't know how to develop them. And if we stop and think about it, we already have lots and lots of skills. All of us, we do, and our students do. So I'm actually going to take a few seconds, stop for a few seconds here, because I would like you to take just a few seconds and do this for yourself. Think of some skills that you have learned, maybe outside classrooms, and then think of some skills that you learned in school. So take just a couple of seconds to do that. And maybe you could just, as you do that, maybe you should, could just type some of them up in the list so we can have a look. That would be great. Also, what I didn't say, sorry, teachers, what I didn't say is, could you specifically think of some of the skills that help you in your job as teachers? Because that's where we're actually going to go with this. Think of some of the skills that you have that are useful as teachers. I don't think you need to look back at the table to do that, but we will go back to the table in a moment. Okay, that's great. I'm seeing quite a lot of, and it's interesting because some of you are listing, you know, what we would refer to as soft skills or transferable skills, like accepting cultural differences, empathizing, critical thinking. Others of you are listing more hard skills, like somebody said, playing the guitar. And those, of course, we do have hard skills as well that help us in the classroom. But let's just go back to the tables for a moment and have a look. And I'd like you to look at these tables and see whether, you know, some of the examples you thought of are some of the things in the tables. So if we go back to this first one, just look at the examples in the sub-skills column. We have listening actively. Do we listen actively as teachers? We certainly do, or I hope we do. Speaking clearly and directly. Empathizing, we do. We have to put ourselves in our students' place, don't we, Gal? You know, when the my favorite is teachers always say they never get the third person S, you know, on the end of the verbs. And I always say to teachers, if you're a non-native English speaker, how long did it take you to do that? Empathize with the students. You know, how long does it take? They're not going to get it overnight. Or for me, I speak Spanish, but I'm a non-native speaker. How long did it take me to get all those subjunctive forms right? And I still make mistakes. So we have to empathize. Things like being assertive. We have to be assertive as teachers. Again, not domineering or bossy, but we have to be assertive and sure of ourselves, don't we? How about things like developing creative, innovative solutions? Thinking logically. In using your initiative, how about evaluating and monitoring your own performance, or developing a long-term vision? I mean, long-term can be even over the semester. What is a vision for the course? Where are you going with it? Organizational skills, managing time, being resourceful. Are teachers resourceful? I think teachers are some of the most resourceful people in the world. Collecting, analyzing, and organizing information. We do that every day, making lesson plans, don't we? Teamworking, working as an individual and as a team. You're in a team with your class, you're in a team with your colleagues. We have to be good at teamwork. Giving and receiving feedback. That's one of the main things we do, don't we? Brainstorming, we do lots of that. What about the next one? Learning and adaptation, adapting to new situations. Oh my goodness. You know, the projector goes out and we have to just suddenly think on our feet and do something else. We do that all the time. Having enthusiasm for ongoing learning. Well, you obviously do or you wouldn't be here, would you? Being prepared to invest time and effort in learning new skills. Of course you are doing that. Numeracy. Ooh, English teachers, we are scared of numbers, aren't we? Many of us. But we all use numbers. We know how to do budgets. We know how to, because this includes not only math. It does. It's not, numeracy is not only to do with math. It's also to do with things like understanding and using charts and graphs. We do that. That's one of the things we teach in our reading skills usually. It also is it also relates to estimating and guessing. We have to do things like that all the time. So numeracy is not only math itself. Working with people irrespective of differences in age, gender, race, religion, or political persuasion. Well, we do that every day, don't we? Both with our students and our colleagues. Respecting cultural differences, of course. That's why we're English teachers, language teachers. And finally, in negotiation skills, negotiating responsively, organizing arguments. You know, we teach students, don't we? Especially if we teach upper levels. We often teach students how to organize arguments if they're going to have a debate or something like that. And finally, applying evaluation criteria. We certainly do that all of the time. So you can see how these sub-skills, you know, almost all of these examples are things that we as teachers use. And I think if your students start to learn what these are, they're going to realize that they have a lot of these skills and that a lot of these skills apply to what they're going to be doing. So, so the next thing that we want to do is to now, precisely, we want the students to look at their list of skills. And we want to ask them to choose three or four of these, maybe, you know, whatever you want to do, and to make some notes about what helped them develop each skill. I have this skill. How did I develop that? And then we can ask them to share those experiences in small groups. So, for example, being assertive. Maybe they said, I'm assertive. I'm good at that. So how did I, why am I, why do I have that skill? So maybe I'm the youngest of five children, so I had to learn to be assertive in order for them to listen to my opinions. Maybe they say I'm a very responsible person. I take responsibility. Well, how did I develop that? Well, many ways, but I specifically remember once when the science teacher let us choose our own projects. We were allowed to miss classes as long as we were working on the project. So we had to be responsible and manage our own time and use that time to work, not just as a free hour. So do you see what I mean here? We actually get students to reflect a little bit, not only on what skills they have, but how did they develop those skills? You know, what makes you have those skills? So that would be the next step in this whole process. By the way, teachers, there are a number of steps here, but don't think that you have to do this all in one class or even over, you know, two classes. You can break these things up. You can stick in these steps, you know, whenever you have a little bit of time in the lesson. And this can be, you know, this can be a whole process. Just as learning these skills is a process, this can be a process that you would do over, you know, several classes or a number of classes, maybe at the beginning of the semester. Okay, what are we going to do next? Now it's time to, you know, once now they've understood what we mean by transferable skills, and they've also understood and identified some of the skills that they think that they have that maybe they didn't even realize they have. So now they realize that they do have some of these skills, but now it's time to focus on, okay, what kinds of skills are going to help you in the job or jobs that you are interested in doing in the future, or maybe the job that you have now. You know, which of these skills are specifically really important to you in your professional area? Because remember, today we are focusing on employability skills. So we want to bring them around to think about getting a job or keeping a job or advancing in their career. So in step six, we're going to ask them to think of a job or jobs that they are interested in the future, and to list at least five employability skills that they think are necessary or desirable for each job. If they're already working, you can ask them to list skills that they think are necessary or desirable for the job they have now. And again, they can refer back to those tables to look at the look at the list of skills. So ask them to focus on maybe five of the most important, some of the skills they think are the most important for their profession. Now, you could ask them to do this individually, or you might want to ask them to do this in pairs or small groups, because, you know, that old brainstorming skill, sometimes it's helpful. It might go faster, you know, if the students do this together. So maybe one student is going to be a doctor, another student is going to be a teacher, another student is going to be an engineer. They can talk together about what kinds of skills they think are very, very important in those jobs. So once they've done that, we then want them to work in groups and discuss their ideas from step six. So ask them to discuss which of the skills on their list they think they already have and which ones they think they need to develop. Now, it's kind of important to here to also get them to think about their group mates. If possible, have them work in groups where they do know each other fairly well, if that's possible. Because a lot of times, have you found, maybe you found in that exercise we did a moment ago, you know, where you wrote down skills that you thought were necessary for teachers. You may have found, oh, gosh, you know, I never thought about the skill of numeracy and that I have some of these skills, but I realize I do have some of those skills. So there may be, you know, there may be skills that students do not realize that they have. And so if they know each other, somebody in the group might say something like, well, wait a minute, you know, you also have the skill of empathizing. I find that you always really listen to what people are saying and you care how other people feel, and you're going to be a doctor. So that's a really important skill. And I think you have that. You know, they can help each other think of what skills are important and what skills they have that they might not even realize they have. So a lot of this is awareness raising. You know, it's helping them understand what the skills are, but it's also raising their awareness about what skills they have that they might not even realize they have. So, I mean, that's basically it. I mean, it's as you can see here, it's sort of seven steps. And again, you know, you may be able to do one or more of these in a class period. You may divide this up over, you know, seven different classes over several weeks, whatever you need to do to get them to do this. Once they've done it, why? What's the point here? What have we done? So what are the objectives? Well, the objectives of this are to help students understand what the skills are and why they're important, and to help them identify transferable skills that employers value. And I also should say, to help them identify skills that they already have, because that's very important. the rationale here is that students have a range of skills that they may not be aware of that are useful in the workplace. They need to recognize the skills that they already possess and how these can be transferred to the workplace. They need to understand the term employability skills in relation to the world of work, and to recognize that certain skills are common to many types of work, as well as to their academic and personal lives. Now, you might want to explain this before you go into this series of activities, so that they know why they're going to be doing this. Or you might want to wait until they've done the activities and then actually do this as a reflection activity. You know, get them to reflect on why they've just gone through this this series of activities and how it could be helpful. And that obviously does involve critical thinking. So you're actually employing one of the skills to get them to reflect on this. Now, teachers, take a deep breath, because you may be saying to yourself, this all sounds nice and all fine and well, but how on earth do I teach this? Is anybody thinking that? Maybe not. Nobody's saying yes, so maybe, oh yes, you are. Okay, all right, here we go. I'm going to answer that for you. Here comes the answer. The answer is, that there's good news and bad news. The good news is that yes, you can learn and develop these soft skills. They're not so nebulous. There are ways that we can develop these skills. The bad news is that it is harder. I mean, it's not like kind of, you know, go home and learn this grammar. And there is no real easy measure of success. I saw somebody wrote a comment while Steve was talking. You know, Steve was talking about developing these digital literacy skills. And one of the comments that I saw in the side box was, how do we evaluate it? Okay, you may not like this answer. Look at the third bullet point here. So like hard skills, soft skills do require a lot of practice to make you good at using them. Unlike hard skills, there are no exams to prove that you can do them. No exams, teachers. Think about it. You measure your success in these skills in how well you ultimately manage the relationships with people around you, your family, your friends, your coworkers, customers, if you are in that kind of job, customers and those who provide you with goods and services. So if we step back for a second, as teachers, we tend to want to test everything. We kind of think, well, if it's worth teaching, then there must be a way to test it. But if you think about it, not all learning is like that. There are many things that we learn and do every day that you can't really test. So I have some advice to you. My advice to you would be, first, use materials that can help students develop these skills so that you don't have a lot of extra, you know, you don't have to look for lots of extra materials, you don't have lots of extra preparation time, and that these things don't interrupt or take extra time from your normal English curriculum. So you want these skills to be built into what you're using. And we're gonna look at that in a minute. Second, don't feel that you have to test everything. Test what you would normally test in your English curriculum. You know, what are the testing objectives of your program? That's what you're gonna test. That's absolutely fine. The soft skills are very difficult to test. Treat them more as an ongoing learning and development process, not as a sort of set of material that you learn and get tested on. You know, first, because it's hard to test them, and second, because students may be a little bit afraid of these skills. It's not that clear all the time what they are, and it's not something that they can kind of take home and study. So, if they know they're not going to be tested on this particular part of your curriculum, of your lessons, they may approach these skills in a more open and relaxed way. I mean, it could be a really enjoyable part of the lesson. It's like, okay, I'm going to learn something, develop something that is sort of creative and useful to me in my life, and I'm not going to have to go home and learn it for a test. So that's what I would recommend to you. So as I think you know, I am one of the co-authors of the Mind series. I mentioned that earlier, along with Steve and Joe. And I'm talking to you about transferable skills today because those skills are a very, very strong part of the syllabus of the series. Some of you may know the Mind series and some of you may not. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with the series, I would like to show you just for a few minutes, I think we've got a couple of minutes left here, about how using materials that have transferable skills built in can help you integrate those into your curriculum without, you know, without poor teachers having to say, oh my gosh, here's another thing that I have to add in here, how do I do it? Okay, well, it can already be built in. So, for example, transferable skills or soft skills, we've called them life skills. We have divided them into three different domains. Remember, we talked about the domains, self and society, study and learning, and work and career. Now, if you look, I've put just a few examples of some of the life skills in the MIND series here. So we've got self and society, establishing priorities, developing cultural awareness, setting goals, things like that. Study and learning, understanding your learning style, estimating and guessing, etc. Work and career, things like thinking creatively, showing initiative, maximizing your potential. Now, the important thing for you to remember and for students to realize is that these things are listed in these categories under these domains simply because of the context of the unit. In other words, every unit, each unit in the MIND series ends with a life skill spread, a life skill lesson. The life skill that we have chosen depends on the topic of the unit. The life skill lesson is related to the topic of the unit. So it's not like it's something completely separate to what you've been doing in your unit. It's related to that. But all of these skills, all of these life skills are transferable, to all of the different domains. So just because they have a lesson on establishing priorities that's in a topic that has to do with their personal lives, self and society, doesn't mean that it's only relevant to that domain. That establishing priorities is also important in study and learning in their academic lives, and it is important in work and career in their professional lives. Let me show you an example so you see what I mean. For example, here is a life skill. Here is a lesson on managing your time. You can see on the top right-hand page that this life skill is being taught, in this case, in the domain of self and society. So in this case, in this lesson, the unit topic is on free time activities and leisure activities and those kinds of things. So in this case, managing your time relates to how you manage the time and all the things that you have to do in your personal life during the week. In other words, you have to work and study and whatever, and then you also have personal things that you want to do and that you have to do. So in this case, the topic is how to manage your time in general in your life with all the things that you have to do. But if you develop the skill of managing your time, that applies to your personal life, to your professional life, and to your academic life. Do you see what I mean? It's a general development. It's a general skill that applies to all areas of life. We happen to have a topic here that is about their private lives. But once they develop the skill, it applies to everything. I hope that's clear to you. And that's how this is set up. That's how these life skills are set up throughout the series. So the topics are very related to the topics of the unit, but all of the skills are transferable to all of the different domains. This is in your English book. It fits in. These lessons are designed to fit in with the amount of time to cover the student's book. So this is not some extra thing that you have to take extra time to do. They're practicing English. They're using things that they've learned in the lesson. The topic is related to the lesson. They are, they're all nice communicative activities. But the difference is, some course books have, there's sort of all the communicative activities are sort of designed to practice the grammar of the unit. These are communicative activities where, yes, they'll be using grammar and vocabulary from the unit, but at the same time, they will be developing this life skill. So it's sort of another element, another layer to the course. Does that make sense to you guys? I hope I'm explaining it well enough. Now, let me show you. Oh, well, first, any questions, anything that I haven't explained clearly? We're just about out of time, but we could probably have a question or two. I realized that somebody in Steve's session said, where can I find material on this? Well, this is where. So we have a British version. And you can see that it goes from a sort of a false beginner level to an advanced level. And we also have an American edition. I think lots of people are with me today from places like, you know, Mexico and Brazil and places like that, right? So you guys probably are interested in the American version. And again, so it's life skills built in, including the stuff Steve was talking about, the digital competency, those spreads, those lessons that he was showing you are all from the series. So, and it's designed for young adults, adults. So, you know, some high, maybe high school on up, certainly university, mostly aimed at sort of university language institutes. And I don't know if there are any other questions. I think we're just about out of time, but I want to thank you all for sharing and being with us today. Thanks for your comments. Language schools, Brazil, especially Brazil, I'm talking to you, language institutes. This is really designed for you. Mexico, universities, other places. So thank you. And I'm seeing, thank you so much, people from places like Egypt and Greece. I'm so excited to have you guys here with us today too. So thank you very, very much. And I hope you get a chance to take a look at the series and enjoy it. So thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Mickey.
Henry, I think we're done.
Yeah, I think we are. Excellent. And guys, I've seen there's been a lot of questions about getting hold of the slides. Well, Mickey's actually prepared a handout for you all. So if you look underneath the video camera where you're seeing Mickey, there's a box called handout. And in there, if you click on the PDF document, you'll be able to download a copy of Mickey's handout that she's prepared for you. So
yeah, it doesn't have the slides, but the whole procedure for doing this as a lesson plan is on there. So
yeah. Exactly. And the slides we can make available as a PDF on our website by the end of the week too. So you'll also be able to grab those as well from there. So Mickey, if you'd like to, you can sign out.
Okay, how do I do that?
You just have to close down the program. So just X off and that will take you
out.
All right. Thanks again for coming today. And
sure.
Such a good talk.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye, teachers.
Bye, Mickey. Okay, everybody. So I'm going to leave us on this screen for a few more moments so that you all get chance to download the PDF handout I was just talking about. Please let me know in the chat box if you're having any problems with that. If you're watching on a mobile device, it might not work as well. But we'll make it available on the website too. So we're just going to need a couple of more minutes here to get things ready for the next talk. Fawzi has just come into the room in the office here in London. So please bear with us and you'll see us on your screens again shortly.
Hello, everybody. Hello, my name is Fawzia. Can you hear me okay? Great, lovely. Well, it's lovely to be here. My name is Fawzia, as I said, and I work in the marketing department. And I'm very happy to be able to show you a demonstration today of our new digital students book. I'll actually show you a few that I've got here in my hand. So this is what the format will look like for Open Mind and Mastermind. So first of all, let's have a quick show of hands or a quick kind of question. How many people here already know and use Mind or Open Mind? Are there any current users already? Just write in the text chat. Yep, there are some. Oh, great. Thank you, Cesar. Some of you, yes. Some of you, not yet. Good. Okay, lovely. Well, so basically, you don't have to have been already using the course in order to, you know more about the Digital Students book. I won't be telling you about the course structure. Mickey and Steve already gave you an overview of some of the skills that there are within the course, such as the life skills, employability skills, and some of the digital type of life skills there too. So this will be purely an introduction to the Digital Students book and also showing you a quick demonstration, sharing my screen of how to navigate the platform. Okay, so someone's saying the sound is quite low. Is this better? Is that a bit louder? Is it? That's better, like, lovely. Okay. So, Alexandra Norma, I will come back to your questions at the end. So if you write the questions towards the end, I'll try to keep an eye on those at the end when it comes to the time for questions, so make sure that nobody's question gets missed out. Okay, so let's begin. Right, so I've just shown you a copy of two of our Digital Students books there, but it comes for the whole series, both the American English version, Mind series, which is Open Mind and Mastermind, and for Open Mind, which is the British English version. So this is the cover of the Digital Students book premium pack for intermediate level, so B1 plus level. Okay, so what exactly is it, you're asking? So, well, it's basically a digital version of the print course book. So if you're already familiar with Open Mind or with, you know, Mastermind, this is actually the course, but in a digital format. So what it has as well is interactive activities. So the activities that are in the student's book, in the course book, they've been produced in an interactive format, so students can do things like drag and drop, fill in the blanks. Basically, they can answer the questions same as they would in their student's book, but this time digitally. It includes the audio and the video. And it also includes other interactive tools, such as a pencil writing tool, a highlighter, personal notes, text box, etc. I'm seeing some comments about the sound. It says there's no sound. Let's see if we can reestablish this. Hello? Hello? I'll just type in. Oops. Hello, are you still able to hear me? Okay, sorry about this. I was getting some queries about the sound, so sorry about the interruption there. So as I mentioned, these interactive tools are all available for the student to use while they're using the Digital Students book. There's also an automatic scoring function. So once the students have done their activities, all of the scores go into a score report, which is relevant to them, to that student. And also they get the chance to submit their answers once they've done the activities. If they got some wrong, they can try again. So again, they're kind of following the process that, you know, you learn by doing, you learn by actually trying the activities. So the score reports are available for each of the levels. The teacher can actually create a class as well. So what the teacher can do is create a class digitally, share the code with the students, and then the students can join the class. And then the teacher then has an overview of all the students in their class. So he or she can then see how their students are doing through their score reports. The teacher can also message the students remind them to do a certain activity, give them some advice about doing some of the activities, and also the students can message the teacher as well. So this two-way messaging function is the feature of the course. And the digital students book, as well as being accessible on a computer or online, it's also tablet accessible. And so if you use it offline, you can sync the scores so that when you're next online, everything will all become synchronized and the up-to-date information will be available. So that's kind of an overview of what it is. Just tell you a little bit more. Who is it for? Some of you are asking. So it's basically an alternative to the print book. If you don't want to use the print course book in your class and your students want to use digital course books, this is the solution for you. So institutions that want to switch from print to digital, or if they want to start their course just using digital, this could be something for them. Also, teachers who want to see their students' progress and just want to constantly be able to monitor that in an online format, they can manage their class digitally using the messaging function, as well as face-to-face, obviously, in the classroom. And this would help to encourage learner autonomy because the students are, you know, kind of being a bit more responsible for their own learning. And it's also a great option for students who wish to experience the course book in a digital format too, either in class, at home, or on the go. And they can use the interactive tools and the inbuilt synchronizing feature for online or offline use. So I'm just looking at some of your questions here. Is it like an app? Claudia, yes, it can be downloaded onto the Me2 app, which is M-E-E-2 app, and then it can be used offline. But when you first register for it, when you first activate the code, you need to be online for that. So it's you access it originally online, and then you can download the app via Me2 and then synchronize it every so often. Okay, so let's see more about this. Do you want to have a look inside? Okay, let's have a look inside. So you can access it depending on your course that you're using. If you're using Mind Series, you can access it through the course website. If you're using one of our other courses, you can access it through our Me2 website. And I'll do a quick demonstration for you in a bit. I'll just show you a few more quick features. This is an example of the teacher creating a class that a student can then use to join that class. So there's a particular page where the students can go in and they can actually type in the code that the teacher has provided to them, and then they can join the class, then be visible to their teacher as a student. Okay, this is a quick look inside. And now I'm going to actually give you a live demonstration. So bear with me a second while I just change my screen. Inez, you're saying there's no sound and no image. It might be that your internet connection is a little bit kind of, you're losing connection a bit, but if it's a sound, try to do your audio wizard. And at the end of the presentation, I will give you more information on where you can get hold of this. Okay. Okay, so bear with me a second while I change screens. And I'm going to hide my video as well. How do I do that? This one? Okay, so I've just turned off my camera now because I'd like you to look at the screen if you would. Oh, share. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if you're using one of our courses, for example, Mind Series, you would access the digital students book through this format. So if you have never used it before, the first thing you would do is to go into the area that says activate code. And the code is available on the inside front cover of your digital students book pack, whether it's a digital students book premium pack or whether it's a digital students book pack. So you'd go into activate code and then you would type in the code. So I'm going to type one that I requested earlier. My slow typing skills. Oops. Oh, no, wait a minute. 3-1. Okay, so you type in the code or you copy and paste it if actually you would actually type it in from the actual inside of your student's book, digital student's book cover, and just make sure you get all of it right and then press continue. Then it asks you to enter your details, so I will just go in with an account. And so it's quality test. My last name is Demo. I'll be Fawzia Test here. And you don't want to know my real date of birth, so let's just say it's January the 1st. I don't know, how young do I want to be? I think I'll put 1995. I feel like I'm 21. Okay, and then you just put your email address here. I will put in one that I prepared earlier. Okay, so this would be your actual email address that you type in here, because you will get a email confirmation, and obviously any further messaging about the product will go to that email address. Okay, so then you choose password. Okay, and you type in your password twice. Whoops. Okay, and then your country. From the drop-down menu, okay. And then don't forget to accept the terms and conditions, and then just press continue to carry on. Okay, sometimes depending on the internet connection, it can be a little bit slower, but you should get the message that says, please confirm you are redeeming access to the following product, and it tells you what you're redeeming access to. So you press confirm if that's the one you wanted, and then it takes you to the page. And then you get a thank you message saying that you're registered. So you can close that. Now, I'm just going to show you. So it takes you back to this page. And you're now behind the login. So you scroll down and you find your resources underneath all the requirements information about the different types of requirements for how to access it. So just go in there and press view, and that will open up the product. Okay, we'll take a quick break here because I'm just going to ask if you have any questions in the text chat. Someone's asking me, what if my country isn't listed there? Alexandra, please contact help@macmillan.com if you don't see your country registered there. Inez, I'm sorry, I can't, I don't know why you have no video and sound. I've turned the video off, but you should be able to see the screen at the moment. And please do try the audio wizard. And can we download it to several devices? Claudia, we can't download it to more than one device because these are personal to each student or to each teacher. So only one product, one device. Okay, just going to show you the next steps. So here's your product. I am a student. I'm going to go into my course just by clicking on it. And there it is. All the course book is on here. So all you need to do is then just go through the different sections. I'll go to Unit 1. Click on the area with the page numbers, and it will open up the course book. So here is my course book. It's page faithful. It's the same thing that you would see in your actual course book, and it has all the activities, all the audio, all the video embedded. For example, you can see the video here. This is the video you get with the course. Whoa. Okay, and go back. Just close the video. So here are the interactive activities. Okay, so you can just do those by clicking on the answers, filling in the gaps. I'll just do a few of those for you now. Submit my answers. I got 7 out of 10. That's not bad, but I want to do better. So I'm going to say try again. And as you can see, it gives me the chance to have a go again, which ones I might have got wrong. Maybe that one. Still got 7 out of 10. I'm not doing very well here. Got that one wrong. And let's see. Whoops. Yes, got 8 out of 10. So that score has now been submitted. So I can close out of that area. Oops, how do I get rid of this, Henry? Sorry, there's something popped up on my screen which I don't need. Ah, there we go. Okay, great. So then I just close that, go back to the page, and then obviously the teacher is teaching from this course book. The student has got it on their tablet or on their computer, and they're following the different steps. So the teacher is still teaching the different stages of the class. It's just the area where the actual activities are being done. They're being done in an interactive format. Okay, so I'm just going to go through a few more. And the next section, another interactive activity. So again, the students would just like answer the question. Look at this web page. Who is it for? I think it's for English students. Let's submit that and see if I'm right. Yes, I got that right. Okay. So I will show you just a few of the tools that we have. We've got a pen tool. If you see this bit at the top, just highlighted. That means I can write here. So my writing isn't very neat when it comes to using a computer, but anyway, I can write. If I want to, I can change the style of that to a different color. So we've got a different color pen there. I can change the size of the font or thickness of the font, and or I can just leave it there. I can use a highlighter as well if I want to highlight some area. That allows me to highlight sentences and highlighted, and then I can change the color of the highlighter too, as you can see. So if I want that really to stand out because I need to remember it for my homework, I can do that. There's a text box, so with this I can just write down anything I want. Just put here difficult. No, sorry, I'll put easy because I'm a confident student. Okay. I can move these around as well, which is quite a nice thing. So if you click on them, you can also move them around wherever I want to on the page. I want the writing to be moved around as well. Oops. And if you double click on the page, you can zoom in, make something bigger. And I can add a personal note. So here, I can make a note, say a translation into another language or a reference to somewhere. I'll put reference, website, say. And it will save that for me. And here's a list of all the resources that particular unit has. So you can see them on the page, actually on the PDFs of the page as you go through it, or you can see them all listed under this tool here. And if you want to see the pages in a continuous format, a bit bigger, you can see them like this and scroll down the page as well. So you've got the option of customizing it like that. And the navigation bar at the bottom as well allows you to just go through the pages as you want. It also shows you the thumbnails, so you can just find it by looking like this. And you can make it bigger or smaller as you wish. You can also search for words. So if I, for example, want to search for, say, vocabulary within this unit, it will find all the examples of vocabulary within my unit. So I can just go and do those particular exercises. Okay. So, and here, this little icon at the top is where my scores are. So at the moment, it's showing that I've done a few activities, not very many. As you saw, I wasn't very good at doing some of them. So I've done a few. It's showing some of my progress there. But then here at the bottom, if I scroll down, it shows me exactly which ones I've done. And it shows me how I did on each one. And it shows me the date I did it as well. So that, again, is a personal score report that I have as a student. What else is very useful to know is that as a student, I can join a classroom. So at the moment, I'm just a student by themselves. But if I click on this add class code, I can then join a class that my teacher has set up. So here's one I've set up earlier. Okay, just type that in. I think that's the number one, actually. One, two, one. Okay, and then I put that in there. I have been assigned to this class, and it says I must wait for the teacher's approval or confirmation to start participating, but that will allow me to join the class. And here, there is a section where I can type a message to teacher, for example. So I'll just put teacher. My teacher is actually Fawzia. Oh, I haven't actually joined the class yet, so I'm not allowed to email anybody. So that would be the next stage. Okay. So I'm just going to put the screen back on. Bear with me a second. Right. Okay. So I'm just having a quick look to see if there's any questions in the meantime. Before I go to the next bit, is it necessary to be connected to the internet when working on the digital format? For the first time, you need to be connected to the internet when you activate your code, when you register. Once you've installed the app onto your tablet, then you can work offline. But then periodically, you should synchronize your tablet to when you're online to make sure all your scores are being recorded. Once downloaded, does it have an expiration time? There is an expiration time. It is for students that they have access to this for 2 years for students. Teachers have access for 4 years. Okay, Carol, it looks like it would work with an interactive whiteboard. Is it so? In theory, yes. Yeah. However, we do have a product especially for interactive whiteboards, which comes with OpenMind called the Presentation Kit. So that would be more suitable, as Emma has just pointed out there as well. Okay, so I'm just going to go in and show you the teacher's view. So this is just showing you that I'm a student here, but I'm going to log out now and I'm going to go back in as a teacher. So as a teacher, I can go in and check on all of my students who have hopefully joined my class. And I can see how they've been doing. Are the scores reports printable? There is a way to, yes, I'll let Emma Jane answer that. Okay, so this is now my teacher's view. I'm a teacher here, but also as a teacher, if I buy the Teacher's Book Premium Plus Pack, I get access to Digital Students Book for free. So teachers get this as part of the Digital Students Book. Teachers get this as part of their Teacher's Premium Plus Pack. Okay, so as a teacher, I can do exactly the same things as the student can. So I can go in, I can look at the activities. Okay, I can make notes. I can do all of these things that the student can do as well. Okay, but more importantly, I can manage my class. So I'll just show you the class management area. So as a teacher here, the content area shows me this page you see here. And if I go into my students, it looks here I've got 5 students in my class. 2 haven't been accepted yet. They've joined my class, but I need to confirm that they're allowed to join. So I'm going to accept David, who just was one of the people that wanted to join. And I'm going to accept Fawzia test, and then I'm going to update. Okay, and I'll do this one as well, update. So now I have my 5 students in the class. They've all joined the class. They all used the code that I gave them, and they're all members of my classroom. Okay, can everybody still hear me okay? I'm getting some text saying that people can't hear me. Do try your audio wizard if you can't hear. That's lovely. So I'm just going to go into my class to see their scores. And there's the button on the top that shows me the class's scores. And okay, so here is my score report for my class. So as you can see, it shows all of the different units for that level. And it shows how the students have done. As you can see, they've not done everything. They haven't been working very hard, as you can see. But here it gives me an overview of how they did with the content they've done so far. It gives you an overall score of based on what they've actually completed. And also it gives me an indication of who might be struggling, who might be, you know, actually doing better than expected. So I'll just go into this student here, to Luis's account. He got 88%, and he's been doing quite well. I go down into his detailed level of information. I can see that he's done first unit, and he's done that very well. Okay, he's needs to try again with the life skills, but that's fine. We've got some great life skills material in Open Mind. Okay, again, little breakdown of all the different activities that students have done. Okay. Right, so that's the score reports. And I told you a bit about the messages. So as a teacher, I can send a message to all of my students if I wish to. So I'll send one to the different students. There's Faye, there's Lewis, there's Emma. And I can just tell them to, you know, try some activity before they come to class. I can tell them to do some grammar consolidation from the grammar reference pages. There's a lot of things that I can actually tell them, and they can message me back as well. Okay. And if I want to search for messages, if I've had a lot of messages from the students, I can actually put the search term here, messages from a particular student, and they will come up. Luis hasn't messaged me yet, but that's fine. Okay. Oh, one thing I wanted to show you was this particular thing on the scores function that you might, sorry, just close that down. On this scores function also, what you have is a area where you can actually write a comment for each student if you want to. So as they do the activities, you can go to the comments box by each of the different sections and write a little comment. You can reward them for having done well. And then that will save it if you press the save icon. Carol, you're asking if the message will go to your email inbox. No, it's actually just within this platform. So you'd need to log in into this, and this is where you'd see them. Okay, so that's a quick overview of the Digital Students book. Are there any questions that you have? Is there anything else that you would like to see again from the platform? Claudia is asking, can the students repeat the same exercise several times? Yes, they can. They can keep trying until they get it right, because at the end of the time, at the end of the day, they're learning by attempting the activity, and they're learning through their own mistakes. Easy to use, thank you. So yeah, I think I've answered that question about the inbox. Can the students repeat the same? Each student has their own access code. Yeah. Okay, can students cheat with the answers, assuming they will have the same code if they're in the same class? Students actually will be in the same class, but I mean, they can only cheat as much as they will cheat if they have the course book and they're looking over somebody's shoulder to look at the answers. I mean, it's again, it's the philosophy within the classroom. If the teacher, that's where the teacher comes in. Stopping the students from cheating is not always possible, but you know, you do the same thing in a class. Does it complement their textbook? It's actually an alternative to using the course book, Maria. So you can either buy the print course book or you can buy the digital version, which is a digital students book. Rosemary, the course code is valid for 2 years, yes. Is B2 digital available? Yes, all of the levels are available for the British version and for the American version. Can they use the book beyond classroom some homework? For the homework part, I would recommend you use the online workbook, which is another feature that Open Mind has. And again, if they get access to the Students Book Premium Pack or the Students Book Digital Students Book Premium Pack, they get access to the online workbook, or they can buy the online workbook separately. Right, I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. It's going to help me, and go back to my PowerPoint. And I want to share some samples with you. Great. Sorry, we're just getting the slides back here. Great stuff. Thank you. And the webcam, can I have that as well? Sorry. Sorry, we're just setting up the slides back again. Eugenia, you asked what software it's for. There is a whole list of the requirements that you need, but basically anything that you can access the internet is, you know, you can access this through that. But mostly Chrome, Internet Explorer, usual internet browsers. And of course, the system requirements for the tablets and computers, they're all on the website as well. So do read them, obviously, when you're interested in finding out more. Okay, so I'm just going to slip through a few of these slides very quickly because we've seen all this already online. And there you go, slide that we've seen these already online. So the next question is, do you want to try it out for yourself? If you liked what you saw so far and you want to try out a free sample, you can either contact your local Macmillan rep who will come around and do a demonstration for you. You can also sample them online because we now have sample units for intermediate level, B1 plus level, for the British version and the American version online. So for the American version, if you're teaching American English, you want Open Mind Level 3, just visit macmillanenglish.com/courses/mind-series-2nd-edition and then follow the related links to get access to Unit 7. So you just get access to one unit from that level. But it's enough to get a good flavor of what it's all about. And you can see how a student would, you know, kind of interact with that. For our British version, Open Mind, you can get access to Unit 8 of Intermediate. Again, go to the website on the screen and follow the related link to get access to Unit 8. And I hope you enjoyed the demonstration. And if you have any questions, please do pop them in the chat box. I love that question. Can we use it on Skype lessons? That's a good question. If you can share the screen, I suppose there's no reason why not. But again, it depends on, you know, the software you're using, what internet browser, if it allows you. But, you know, it depends on how you deliver your teaching, if you teach it face-to-face or if you if you deliver your teaching virtually. I suppose you can adapt it to other means. Can you carry your membership from computer to computer? Because it's online, you just need your logins, your username login and your password, which you had when you created your account. And if you've downloaded the app on your tablet, again, just make sure you keep synchronizing every so often to make sure your scores are saved. But yes, overhead projector. Again, this version is for students. We do have a presentation kit for interactive whiteboards, which comes with a series, and that comes as part of your teacher's pack. So again, you've got a version specifically for interactive whiteboards too. So the teacher can be using the IWB version at the same time as the students are using their tablet or computer versions, and you can run the class in that kind of multimedia kind of way with them. Okay, lovely. Thank you very much for your comments. Lovely. Yes, that's true. So do contact your rep if you have any other questions, or contact us at help@macmillan.com and we'll be happy to answer as well. So thank you very much. Alexandra, the price, you need to find the price out from your local Macmillan rep, but it should be the same price as the course book, the actual print course book. Okay, thank you very much for your time. Thank you. And do stay with us on the session because I'm going to do a quick presentation now about our new competition that we have where your students can win the chance to get 2 weeks work experience here in London. So I'm just going to switch over the slides and thank you for joining this session and for your very interesting questions. I hope you're interested to find out more. I do have a handout to share. Actually, what I'll do, I'll just keep this slide on there for you for a bit longer so you can copy down those links. And that's where you can get your samples. The certificates will be sent at the end of the session. I've just had confirmation. And the handout will be sent then as well. The handout is basically this slide with the links on it. So great. I'm glad you could join me on that one. Thank you. So I'm just going to change slides now. Thank you. Okay, hi. Thank you for staying with us for this afternoon of events and sessions that we've had. I hope you've enjoyed it so far. I certainly enjoyed the great presentation that Steve did on digital competence skills and the one that Mickey did on employability skills. It certainly kind of was very, very interesting, and it was great to see all your participation and your comments on that as well. So sticking with the theme of employability skills, as Mickey was mentioning, and as also kind of Steve has mentioned as well through his digital competence skills session, with Open Mind, with the course Mind series with Open Mind, a lot of the life skills that are embedded in that work around the area of work and career. So these employability skills are something that a lot of our students want in this day. So we have organized this year a competition which gives the chance for students around the world. It gives them a chance to win 2 weeks work experience here in our London Macmillan Education Office. So, what is the Mind Work Experience Competition? Okay, so basically, why are we offering a work experience competition? Well, as educators and as publishers of educational materials, as teachers, we know that language skills and life skills are all an essential requirement in today's competitive world. And the winners of this competition, they would get a valuable insight into a variety of roles within a global educational publishing company. They'd get the chance to experience work in a leading company which would be useful for their future career. And entering the competition also helps develop your students' language skills and their life skills. So Mind Series and Open Mind are the two courses which have life skills for employability inside, as you saw a little bit from the example that Mickey gave you. So this is why we're running the competition. It's in conjunction with Mind, with Open Mind and Mind Series. However, you don't have to be a user of Open Mind in order to enter the competition. Students, adult students over the age of 18, from anywhere around the world, as long as they're English language students, can apply to enter the competition. So, what do the lucky winners win? What do they get? Well, there are three first prizes. And those three lucky winners, once they've gone through the different stages, will win 2 weeks in the London office. And again, there will be three main winners. The prize includes, for those three main winners, flights, accommodation, and also an allowance for meal. So during that 2 weeks that they're here, doing their work experience, they don't have to worry about anything financially. These things are covered. So what about the runners-up? Well, people who don't actually make it to the first three places, they also get a runners-up prize. They win coaching sessions from a top business coaching specialist. So again, developing those employability skills in the student is what we are actually aiming to do with this competition. Does anybody have any questions so far? If you have questions, please write them in the text chats. Sorry, I'm just getting my screen to appear. Great. Okay, lovely. So no questions so far. That's great. So what do you have to do? What do students have to do? Well, the first thing they have to do is to go online. And the website address is www.macmillanenglish.com/mind-competition. And then we recommend that they read the information and terms and conditions on there, because full information is given on the website. They would then submit a curriculum vitae or resume, plus do a presentation. And the presentation would be in PowerPoint or Prezi, and it would have the following topic: how has education changed in the past 10 years, and how do you see it changing in the next 10 years? Once they've done that, once they've checked that, you know, they've complied with the competition requirements, they'd email their entry to the website, that to the email address that's on the website, and make sure that it comes to us by 30th of November 2016. Okay, some people are asking me a question. Age, 18 plus. The students would have to be 18 or over by the time the competition actually kind of closes, or by the time the prize is actually given, because as adults, they, well, as minors, it's a lot more difficult for them to come and do this work experience kind of thing here. Okay, so why should your students enter? Well, let's hear from somebody who's actually done the work experience here for himself. So this is Bram. Bram was a work experience student who came to us from Holland for a few weeks. And this is what he says. I would definitely recommend a work experience at Macmillan Education. I have enjoyed my time and it was very valuable. I have been in several companies during my studies and Macmillan was the most open and intelligent company I visited. If you choose to do your work experience here, you'll get the chance to boost your skill area, enjoy a fabulous city, and work with the friendliest staff I ever encountered. So this is straight from the horse's mouth, as it were. So these are some good reasons why your students might also benefit. So what are the stages after the students have applied? Well, after the students have sent in their entry by the 30th of November, we will then, an independent panel of judges will check all of those. And we will shortlist 15 of those. Those 15 people who are shortlisted will then get the chance to be interviewed online by people from Macmillan Education. And they'll also get the chance to give their presentation during the interview. So they'll do a virtual presentation on the topic that they had submitted earlier. And then from those 15, three first prize winners will be chosen. And they'll get the 2 weeks work experience. And there will be three runners-up chosen to do the business coaching prize. And then we would be announcing the winners in February 2017. So after all the processes have taken place, that's when the announcements will happen. And then the work experience and the coaching prizes will take place in spring 2017. And the exact dates are to be confirmed because obviously it will depend on a number of different factors, but spring 2017. The age limits and other vital information is all on the terms and conditions. So students have to be 18 plus, over 18. And you can read more and see the full terms and conditions online at macmillanenglish.com/mind-competition. If you go online to that website as well, you'll find that there's also some competition classroom posters as well. So you can download them, print them out, and use them to decorate your classroom or to help to encourage your students to apply for the competition. You can also ask your Macmillan rep for a huge size poster as well, which we also have available. So some people are asking questions. When does the competition open? It's already open, Alexandra, but it closes on the 30th of November. How about the level of English? Norma, we would recommend that the students have a level of English that allows them to actually, participate in a working environment in the United Kingdom. So a level of English that allows them to communicate, with some confidence. Some of the questions, what will the winners be doing? They would be having the chance to do work experience with colleagues in marketing, in editorial, in media, and in digital production as well. So different departments of the company, as and when, the actual kind of work experience students come over. Okay. The certificates window. Yes, with the certificates, they will be sent out towards the end. So don't worry about that. Okay. Somebody asked, are all the winners going to be together during the work experience? This is what the ideal scenario would be. However, we will take into consideration if there are some students, winners, who can't come at that time. So again, this will depend on a few different factors. Okay. Can students who will be 18 in spring 2000, yes, that's fine. If they're 18 by spring 2017, then that's fine. They can also apply. Okay, just going to go to the next slide. And so I was telling you something about the other resources for employability that we have. We have got some videos for employability skills, skills for work. We've got lesson plans, and we've got a lot more on our website. So sometimes you want to give your students some tips and hints on how to, you know, get vital work-related skills, things like interview skills, group discussion, presenting, team working, all of these different skills. Well, our series of videos that we have give students like an interesting way to look at these topics. It's very humorous, it's very engaging. And also there are some teacher resources such as video worksheets and teacher's notes that you can download and teach these in class as well. Plus, there's a new CV and cover letter lesson plan available on the website as well. So just go to this website here. I'm just gonna highlight that for you here with my highlighter tool. It's this one. There you go. So go to this website here, www.macmillanenglish.com/employability-videos. And you can pick up all of these free resources that we have there. Okay. And you may be wondering, that competition is for students. Do we have anything for teachers? Well, yes, you are actually lucky because we do have a great scholarship initiative for teachers, which actually is still open, but it's going to close tomorrow. So, bear with me, I need to get rid of that tool there. So it's going to close tomorrow, this competition. This is for a teacher to get the chance to win a sponsorship from Macmillan Education, and they get the chance to present a talk at IATEFL 2017 in Glasgow. What else do they win? Well, the lucky teacher who makes it to the winning stage also gets mentoring and presentation training from our teacher professional development team. And this competition is open to any teachers who are currently teaching in any area of English language teaching. And the award includes £800 towards travel, accommodation and costs, 1 year's IATEFL membership, and a year subscription to onestopenglish.com. So for teachers who want to apply for this this scholarship scheme, please go to macmillanenglish.com/IATEFL-2017-scholarship. But do hurry because applications close Thursday, 21st of July. And go to the website to find out how you can apply for this scholarship scheme. Okay, the teachers can be from any country, but I recommend that you go to the website to find out the full list of information that's available and also how you can actually make the application because it has to be through the IATEFL website. So, Alexandra, there is a task based around this, but the website will give you more information. And the teacher that delivers the most outstanding application would be the one that wins. But the website gives you more information. Okay, I'm just going to the next slide. So, with regards to the work experience competition, good luck to all of your students who I hope will want to enter this. And good luck to all the teachers that want to apply for the IATEFL scholarship as well. For information about the Mind Work Experience competition, please refer to the website here. And for the IATEFL competition scholarship, please refer to the website here. Are there any other questions? Okay, the certificates and everything will be shared with you in a little bit. We'll be sending those over to you at the end of the session. Thank you very much for your very kind comments, Nicoletta, that's very kind of you. Brilliant, that's fantastic, thank you so much. I hope you've all enjoyed our sessions of presentations today, and thank you very much for staying with us. Again, if you have any questions for me or for any of the presenters, for Steve or for Mickey earlier, please do get in touch at help.macmillan.com and we'd be happy to answer. Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.
So thanks to Fawzia, and as she said, please check out the web page and tell all your students about our great competition. We look forward to seeing their entries. Now's the part of the day where we hand over the certificates, which I see a few of you have been asking about. So if you go to the box that's now filling the screen where the slides were, you can see there's a certificate waiting for you in there. You just need to simply click on it and download it to your computer, remembering to add your name and signature when you print it out. I've also just added Fawzia's handout there from her earlier presentation of the Digital Students book as well, so that you've got a copy of that. And that has in it all the links that you need that were mentioned earlier. Please, if anybody's got any further questions or is having difficulty, then let me know in the chat box. I will stay signed in for a few more minutes just to address anything additional. And one other thing to note, when I close down the webinar shortly, you'll be redirected to a web page to take a survey. And we'd really appreciate it if you could take the time to just tell us your thoughts on today's webinar and how it could be improved. It just helps us plan future events. If anybody's got any additional questions about the competition, by the way, I can't address those myself, but I've put Fawzia's email address in there so you can write to her, and I'm sure she'd be happy to help. The webinar files, so you mean the presentations, Rosemary, the slides, they will all go up online in the next couple of days. So check our social media pages and we'll update you when they've been put up. But if you basically go to Macmillan English and go to the webinar section, there's an archive in there and you can watch back the recordings of all our webinars this year so far and download as PDFs the PowerPoint presentations too. So I'll leave things up for a few more seconds, and then unfortunately I'm going to have to go. It's very sunny here for a change. It's been over 30 degrees, so we've got to go out and enjoy it while it lasts. If you're looking for Mickey's handout, yep, I can sort that out. 1 second. So Mickey's handout is on the new screen that's now come up in the box where it says handout. So just click that if you'd like it. Okay then, so I'm going to close things down, and as I said before, you'll be redirected to the survey. It would be really great if you could spare the time to go through the questions for us and answer them. And I hope to see you all at our next webinar, which I believe will now be in September. So stay safe until then, and keep following us on social media, and we'll see each other again soon. Okay. Bye for now.